My topic today is the Lost Tribe. I propose to look in detail the story and life of an artist who lived and worked in pre-war Singapore in the 1920s through the Second World War and until the early post-war years. I want to look at his life and work as a microcosm of a larger cohort of artists like himself. It has been an intensive but very interesting investigation over 2 years. And thanks to the Lu Heng Research Fellowship, I was able to uncover a lot of things on these artists. My work is by no means completed, but hopefully we'll be able to present these artists as a sort of prequel to the standard conventional art historical narrative of Singapore. My presentation today has an ironic start. Here are two large oil paintings of the Chinese high school. They were hanging for many years in the main school hall. They are monumental, each measuring about 2 meters 70 in height, 2 meters 10 in width. Painted on board in oil, they depict different views of Chinese high school campus and also the iconic buildings that you can see in the school. They're both painted by the art teachers of the school of the time in 1948 as part of a major fundraising effort. The painting on the left features the approach to the iconic clock tower. The driveway is on the ascent. As you know, the school is built on a hill along Bukit Timah Road. The painting is ambitious. It's also majestic. The painter was Cheong Soo Ping, who was about 30 years old then in 1948. He's relatively new to the school, probably only started working there in 1947. But Mr. Cheong was going to be one of the most well-known artists in Singapore later, and even in Southeast Asia. He's a recipient of the prestigious cultural medallion, and he's canonized as a pioneer artist of Singapore. His art defines the essence of modern and contemporary art of Singapore. This painting is one of his earliest and largest works. So it is no wonder that a few years ago, when a visitor saw this painting in relatively poor condition, he was outraged, and his outrage stirred up a wave of criticisms in the press and drew so much attention from the public. Such is the gravitas of Cheong Soo Ping. The painting on the right-hand side takes an oblique view of the Kuo Chuan building, named after the father of its big donor, Lu Heng, who incidentally is also the patron of the research fellowship. Mr. Li was probably the wealthiest philanthropist in the post-war year of Singapore. So this painting offers an indirect perspective of the school's very well-known architecture, resting on a green shaded by the generous canopy of the trees. The artist seemed to have an intimate appreciation of the school's terrain, the nooks and crannies, and how the shadows would cast on things. It's painted with a more nuanced palette, giving a luxury to the lushness of the green and a warmth to the earth tones. So in contrast to Cheong Soo Ping's brightly lit, the you see it all approach to the iconic facade of the school, this particular artist is suggesting to us the way to experience the most alluring moments of the school. So who is this artist? This artist is Lu Heng. He was about 46 years old in 1948. He taught Chinese High between 1935 and 38, and then again in 1946 and 1950. During my research, I read all the Chinese High yearbooks cover to cover, line by line. They really show us how Lu Heng taught primarily art, but also Chinese language from time to time. He also took up quite a bit of ECA responsibilities in the school, like he took the students to swimming classes at the Chinese swimming club. Besides art teaching, he was also designing and coordinating the publication of the school's yearbooks. Lu Heng made artwork for the covers of the 1938 and 1948 school books based on similar compositions of the Chinese high architecture. The 1938 copy is on the left-hand side, and the 1948 cover is on the right-hand side. These covers show the versatility of Lu Heng in various different mediums, from sketching and woodcut. So both these works are brilliant. Lu Heng also lived on the campus of Chinese High, and so he had a lot of time to observe the vast campus and the small plots of rubber trees and woods surrounding the school. This monumental painting is based on these works that he had done over the years, which also explains the interesting and personal perspective that he had adopted for the monumental oil painting, and also the immersive mood that he had created for us in this work. These are indicators that this is a highly competent and mature artist. Lu Heng was very much a self-taught artist, where at this point of time, I'm still not able to ascertain the formal art education that he had gone through. But we know for a fact that after arriving in Singapore, Lu Heng devoted much of his spare time painting. And in 1935, becoming one of the founding members of the Society of Chinese Artists was probably a major milestone in his artistic career. So he gained more opportunities to make art with like-minded people. He went on sketching trips. He would exhibit works regularly in group shows. Joining the society also gave him chances of meeting and observing firsthand prominent and established artists who were visiting from China, and they were often hosted by the society members. In this picture, it was a group photograph taken after the society had hosted a famous sculptor also visiting Singapore. His name is Zheng He. Well, Mr. Zheng was coming through Singapore from France at the time in 1937, but found himself stranded in Singapore because Marco Polo Bridge incident had just broken out in China and starting the Sino-Japanese War. So he was stranded in Singapore for a good half a year, happily he was getting sculpturing commission and also design work. So here you are, you have the members of the society gathering after a nice dinner, and you could see they're all full of youth and happiness gathering around a famous artist. This is a very important picture because it shows Xu Beihong and the visiting Xu Beihong was the doyen of Chinese art at the time. This picture was taken 1939. And the society members, together with Xu Beihong, were hosting Yu Shikai, who was a famous cartoonist visiting Singapore from Kunming at the time. So reading the entries of Singapore dailies regarding the society and artists, Lu Heng would really come across as an oil painter who contributed a great number of oil paintings each time the society presented the annual exhibition. Unfortunately, none of these works has yet to surface for us. Once in a while, Lu's works will be mentioned in special features published by the dailies. The image of this one and only Western-styled work by Lu Heng is preciously encapsulated in the 1937 special issue of the Singapore Free Press and Mercantile Advertiser. In this painting, which is entitled Practice, Lu Heng once again shows us his talent in drawing and his great competence in depicting human figures. This is actually a rare, very rare example of Lu Heng's portraiture works. From 1939 onwards, however, Lu Heng began to show more and more Chinese paintings in the society exhibitions and later on in the exhibitions organized by the Nanyang Academy of Fine Arts, where he taught after World War II. The extant work of Lu Heng, which are still available in Singapore today, are all Chinese ink works. When these paintings resurfaced in 2017, after what seems to be a hibernation of 68 years, there was a joy and excitement of looking at new works by an unknown artist. So there is a freshness, spontaneity, and a sense of urgency in the very expressive art brushwork that you see in his paintings. There is also a kind of tropical spirit that Lu Heng was trying to instill in his art. He substituted, for example, Chinese birds like the Mandarin ducks with minor birds, as you could see in the painting on the far left. He painted a lot of palm trees in place of pine trees and bamboos. He painted storms, and you can see in the painting featured in the middle of the slide how vividly Lu Heng captured the velocity of the wind, sending rain beating down the leaves of palm trees. Naturally surrounded by dynamic artistic energy in the society and stimulated by his co-workers, Lu Heng's talent clearly blossomed. In 1939, he's financially struggling. The Second World War had just broken out in Europe. Lu received an important recognition from Xu Beihong, the great painter from China. Although Xu Beihong was often obliged to shower praises and he had to offer encouragements on his younger admirers and mentees in Singapore, his comment to Lu is very special. He wrote a colophon on Lu Heng's Chinese ink works featured here and featured in the 1939 exhibition. The colophon says that Xu Beihong himself, he said that he saw the spirit of Xu Wei and the touch of Ba Da Shan Ren in Lu Heng's painting. Now, Xu Wei and Ba Da Shan Ren are two of the greatest freestyle ink painters of the 16th and 17th century China. This must have been the high point from which Lu Heng's career was supposed to take off. But did it take off? We'll see later. Just a little bit of a digression from my main topic. Exhibition catalogues are incredibly rare in the pre-war days. So the Society of Chinese Artists only managed to pull together full catalogues of all the participating artists for their exhibitions in 1939 and 1940. Likewise, the commemorative exhibition catalogue of the Nanyang Academy of Fine Arts, published in 1946 on the left, and the Nanyang Xiangbao special edition dedicated to the society show are stoic and poignant signs of the recovery amongst the Chinese artists after the trauma of World War II. Despite the poor printing quality, these are exceptionally precious documents and proofs of the vitality of our artist community in times of hardship and sadness. With the Lee Kong Chian Fellowship, I was able to further research to uncover the identity, life stories, and artistic career of most of the artists active in pre-war Singapore. However, their presence in the current discussion of our art history is eerily disturbing. It seems wrong to leave them as ghosts of the past, haunting museum curators and art historians like myself. Much of the discovery they've made have been written up in a longer paper, which I hope you get to read eventually. But for now, let's go back to this group photograph of the Society of Chinese Artists in 1935 and to see what happened to some of them. Well, the good news is one of them became a much venerated pioneer artist who brought about a new interpretation of expression of Chinese ink paintings in Singapore. He is Chen Zongrui, Chen Chongsui, the man circled in lime green in the middle. Circled in a light grey, these three men died tragically during the Japanese occupation of Singapore in 1942. On the right-hand side of the picture, Zhang Ruqi, who was chairman of the society, and Wu Chao. On the far left of the photograph was Zhang Ruqi's brother-in-law and partner of the United Painters Studio, a thriving design business they ran from 1934 right up to the fall of Singapore in 1942. Lin Dao'an is the tall man wearing spectacles, standing in the middle, very tall man, circled in light grey again. He was the pictorial editor of Xinzhou Ribao, journalist and cartoonist in Singapore and Hong Kong. Now, these three men were artistic movers and shakers in the wartime effort of Singapore. They were involved in many fundraisers for the China Relief Funds in a very high-profile way, and they were swiftly rounded up by the Japanese during the Suqing operation. Their families never saw them again after they were taken away. Circled in fuchsia pink, these men returned to China during the post-war years, and they are Lu Heng, fourth from the right-hand side, the leading man of this talk, Xu Junlian standing next to him, who is also a Xinzhou Ribao journalist, an editor, cartoonist, and novelist. Dai Yinglang is the one shorter man wearing spectacles to the left, circled in fuchsia red. He was a proponent of social and political responsibility of art of the time. Xu Junlian and Dai Yinglang survived the turbulence and purges under the new communist regime in China, but not Lu Heng. In his poor health, Lu was exiled to do hard labor and for re-education in the countryside of Guangdong. Eventually, he died of illness alone. His family was separated from him, and they only knew about his death weeks after it had happened. As such, we get to know that Lu matured as an artist and made his best works in Singapore. The only watercolor work that is available to us can be found in China. And apart from this watercolor work, Lu didn't leave anything in China. So it's very important for us to claim Lu Heng as a Singapore artist whose life path is just fraught with wrong timing. The other artists continued to paint as society members, to teach in art schools and to teach also privately. Together, they spend their youth as colleagues making art and giving inspirations to each other. As a community of artistic minds and creative energy, they are all trailblazers of a path in the development of art in Singapore as we witness it today. Their history and their stories should be written in full. Thank you.